Good morning, everyone. It's just turned 10 o'clock, so we'll make a start. Welcome to our latest financial services webinar. I'm Paul Staples. I'm an associate director in Grant Thornton's financial services group. I hope you're all keeping well and very pleased to welcome many of you today from a variety of payment and e-money firms. Now, the payment sector is certainly one of the FCA's supervisory priorities. So in order to prosper, businesses are going to need to effectively respond to the various regulatory headwinds that are coming at you. And over the next hour or so, we're planning to provide you with a timely update on areas including safeguarding, wind down plans, and also the new insolvency regime. But first of all, the inevitable housekeeping points. So please do get involved. You can submit any questions or comments to us via the controls panel on the right-hand side of your screen. And we'll aim to cover as many of your questions as possible towards the end of this session, or indeed reply to you individually afterwards. Also, we are recording this webinar and it will be shared with you after the event to everyone who's registered. But this morning, I'm very pleased to be joined by two of my colleagues. First of all, Shameen Kazmi. Good morning, Shameen.
Hi, good morning.
Shameen is a partner in our financial services audit practice where she leads our safeguarding work. We'll be hearing from Shameen. And also Will Stagg. Good morning, Will.
Morning, Paul.
Will's a director in our restructuring and insolvency practice. So to our agenda then. So over the next hour or so, initially I'm going to be looking to set the scene with a brief overview of the current regulatory landscape for your sector. And then I'll hand over to Shameen, who will be taking us through some key developments around safeguarding. And then Will's going to update us in terms of firms' progress and perspectives on wind down plans, and finish off with some insights into the new insolvency regime. But first of all, let's get you all involved. So we're going to start with a very quick poll, and hopefully this will pop up on your screens now. There we go. And the question we'd like to ask you all is, how would you describe your current safeguarding arrangements? Please select one of the following. Perhaps you think you've got really well-defined safeguarding environments, strong controls. Perhaps you just think it's fit for purpose. Perhaps there's a need for some improved documentation, but things are generally okay. Perhaps in the third case, you've actually identified some remedial corrective actions that are required. Maybe there's a program of work ongoing. Or fourthly, perhaps you've actually got some fundamental concerns, and maybe that's why you're here today. So we're just going to wait for those results to come in, and appreciate that's a generalisation of where you might, very difficult to generalise in terms of where a firm is, but just good to get a sense check here in terms of where people are. Okay, well, the good news is that almost half of you do believe that you've got a strong and steady safeguarding environment. Pleased to see no one thinks or is willing to admit that your safeguarding arrangements are lacking or ineffective, but interestingly, a quarter of you thinking that perhaps there's certainly grounds for some improvement. So let's reflect on that over the next half an hour or so. And just by way of a reminder, any questions that you do put through in the chat function are obviously anonymous, so they're not attributable to anyone in particular, and we're sure that's the case. So on to the regulatory landscape. So there are a number of market and economic factors that are combining here and triggering responses from regulators and lawmakers. As you know, this sector continues to experience high growth, but this does not necessarily translate to profitability or financial resilience. So indeed, we've seen a number of insolvencies in recent years in this sector, and such events inevitably can raise some fundamental questions around market confidence and customer protection. So rightly so, these sorts of drivers have really required a regulatory response. So for example, the FCA has been particularly active since 2019 in its thematic work, it's issued guidance, DSCEO letters, it's updated its approach document, and also importantly, it's imposed a new annual safeguarding audit requirement that Shamim's going to be talking to about shortly. But more strategically, I think we can see how safeguarding, wind down plans, and the new insolvency rules are discrete but complementary frameworks, and together they can come together to strengthen the sector and the trust and confidence that everyone has in the market. So on to some other key developments. Now, thanks to the Financial Times and Netflix, the collapse of Wirecard is now very much well documented. But it was actually one particular statement from the FCA last year that really got my attention personally. And they confirmed that across five insolvencies, there had been shortfalls in customer funds amounting to £40 million. So that really does sharpen our mind in terms of why these rules and regulations are there in terms of the protection of the end consumers. So it's good to see that the safeguarding requirements are growing in prominence. And also, we've seen the arrival of a new specific insolvency regime. In addition to that, there's also the prospect of the regulatory perimeter widening. For example, in the case of crypto assets, in particular stable coins, that will fall under the money regulations. So there's a lot going on here. But now we're going to take a closer look at safeguarding, and I'm going to hand over to Shamim. Thanks, Shamim.
Thanks, Paul. So good morning, all. What I'd like to cover in this session is really do a little bit of recap on the safeguarding audit itself in terms of the requirements, some of the specific details and frameworks around the audit itself, and then we'll touch upon and go into some of the insights learned from the latest audits that we've done. So as Paul alluded to, in terms of the regulatory mindset, in terms of the regulatory scrutiny, clearly safeguarding is growing prominence. It continues to be and continues to raise on the radar of the FCA in terms of regulatory priority and significance. And you can see that, you know, Paul mentioned in terms of the 40 million shortfall in terms of the recent insolvency, and that gives perspective to why safeguarding is so important and fundamental in this sector. The key FCA concerns, which led to really tightening of the rules around the safeguarding, around the assurance that they require around this area, are all to do with the fact that, you know, they see the payment services sector as well as the e-money sector as a very hard, high growth, but also a fast-moving sector in terms of where the business models are evolving. You know, it could be an introduction of different regulatory remits of which they're adding onto the regulation, what's now in scope of payment services, the e-money models and how they interact with the payment services as well. So there's not a lot of movement, not only in terms of the growth of this sector, but also the evolution of the business models, fair to say. The FCA's concerns are around the lack of robust prudential risk management, and they have sort of alluded to that. They continue to mention that in the business plans as well. And linked with that comes the lack of consumer protection. And that's to all to do with, well, this sector is dealing more and more with a lot of high scale, high volume, relevant funds, consumer funds. How are they protected? How are organizations putting in place adequate organizational arrangements? And at the same time, what is the level of understanding of the end customer in terms of understanding how their funds are protected? So coupled with and based on all of these concerns that the regulator have, the scrutiny continues, the bar keeps on getting higher. Some of the FCA findings from the thematic reviews back in 2019, post which you know, they carried out an attestation process and then followed on a lot of additional guidance and requirements from the FCA, concerned were raised around when they did the thematic reviews around this sector in terms of safeguarding. You can see on the slide there was a lack of understanding of the business models and relevant fund flows, which I just alluded to earlier as well. And that's probably because of the way these models are evolving and the payment chain, the payment channels, the introduction of the crypto angles, as well as the interaction between the payment services and e-money. So the FCA felt, from their reviews, that there was a little bit of ambiguity and understanding of real, the business models and how the funds are arising and dealt with in these businesses. The designation and setup of safeguarding accounts, clearly there were concerns around that as well. Is that really formalized? Is the trust status really provided to the accounts which are holding the funds that these institutions and firms are holding on behalf of the customers? We see a growth in the use of agents and third parties in terms of the payment services sector as well as the e-money sector. And again, here the FCA's focus continues on the oversight of these agents and distributors, because clearly it's not only the firm, but somebody else who is responsible for the funds and flows in these models. So the oversight and a robust oversight of these agents and distributors is absolutely fundamental as well. Another area of concern raised was effectiveness of reconciliations as well as the governance and oversights, which we've mentioned. So those were all the concerns that the FCA had, which led to then the tightening of the requirements, the rules, and what the expectations of the FCA was from this sector. So if we move on then, so what did that lead to? So if we can move on to the next slide, please. Then that led to in 2019, post the thematic review, attestation process came in. July 2020 is when the safeguarding audit requirement came into place. So the DSCO letters were issued, the finalized guidance was issued, and as part of that, all the firms that were falling within the remit and scope of safeguarding, i.e. required to comply with the safeguarding requirements under the PSRs and EMR regime, they were required to have an annual audit of compliance with the requirements. Now, there are some firms which are falling within the voluntary regime, so they can voluntarily apply the safeguarding requirements. It's not mandated for them. And those are the small payment institutions. They're the small EMIs with unrelated payment services. So there are certain specificities and requirements where certain firms do not have to comply with the safeguarding requirements, but they can voluntarily do so. But one point to note here is that we did see in the revision of the approach document in November 21, even though the FCA has sort of noted that there are certain firms falling which can voluntarily apply these requirements, it is very much encouraged to do so. And if they're not doing it and not applying and complying with the safeguarding requirements, then they really need to be in a position to demonstrate to the FCA how they have afforded protection to the customer funds. So that's a little bit on the scoping of these audits. Now, what exactly are these audits? It is an annual audit of compliance with the safeguarding requirements. Just to reiterate, it's not new. The PSRs and the EMRs have been there for a long time. The safeguarding requirements and obligation on these firms has been in the regulations. But what the FCA did is really mandate and clarify the required need for an annual audit of these requirements. So the firm should have been complying with these requirements since the point of authorization, but the audit is the new thing that was overlaid in 2020. The audit needs to be carried out by an audit firm or an independent external firm or consultant. But the point to note, which has been reiterated due to the importance of these regulations and the risk with the sector, is that due care, skill and diligence must be exercised in appointing to the auditor for the purposes. So that's what the requirement is. Now let's talk about some of the key things on the framework of this audit. What exactly is this audit? So this audit for the safeguarding requirement is a reasonable assurance opinion. It's an opinion on the systems and controls that the organization has in place to comply with the safeguarding requirements. You must be aware that firms must be aware that there is actually no mandated standard under which the FCA stipulated or you're required to carry out the audit. Just for example, for the CAS regime, the client asset regime, there is an FRC standard, but there is no such standard at the moment for the safeguarding audits. Now, in the absence of that, given it's a reasonable assurance opinion, across the industry, it has been, there have been discussions, and the FCA has noted in the revised approach document that in the absence of a standard, the ISO 3000 can be used as a relevant standard for these audits. So auditors or firms carrying out these audits can use that as a framework for these audits. Type 2 report, the reason I note that there is, I've just mentioned that this audit is an audit on the systems and controls, but it's not only on the design, but also on the operating effectiveness of the controls. So the auditor must be looking at both the elements of the controls. Also, the opinion is not only during the period, but also at the period end. Again, once the firm has selected and agreed a period for the safeguarding audit, the testing must be done to cover not only the whole period, but also at the period end, because that's part of the opinion that has been stipulated by the FCA. Now, when we turn around and say, well, actually, the safeguarding audit requirements and the rules are there in the overarching regulations of the PSR and the EMR, but actually the FCA's expectations of what and how to comply with the requirements has been over time, over the last 2 years specifically, they have been consolidated into chapter 10 of the approach document. Post 2020, there was a lot of, there were some DSCO letters, there were some guidance issued by the FCA, but pretty much all of them have been consolidated and built into the revised version 5 of the approach document, which came out in November 21. So that is the chapter that contains the detailed guidance around what are the safeguarding requirements and what are the firms required to comply with. Now, once you've agreed the period for these audits, at the moment, as you're aware, because this is not stipulated in any underlying laws and regulation, there is no timing or there's no deadline for the submission of these reports. Again, using the CAS regime as the closest reference point, the FCA has noted and acknowledged that the submission of the reports could be within 4 months of the period end. So it's good to use that as a base when you're looking at these reports. So I hope that's given a bit of feel about what exactly the safeguarding audit is, what is the scoping of these audits, and a little bit about the framework and the type of opinion on the audits itself. So then if we can move on and talk about, well, what's happened over the last 2 years. So just as a recap, the requirement came out in 2020. Clearly, firms have been at different points since that 2020 in terms of their journey. How ready were they to be able to ready for an audit, to have the scrutiny on their systems and controls? And we've seen variations in the market. It's fair to say, based on our experience and the industry experience and insights, firms are in the process of remediation of findings from the first year audits. Most of the firms have carried out first year audits. They're in the process of remediating the findings, and they are getting ready for the second year audit. However, some firms are still to complete the first year audit and still in the process of looking at it and engaging an auditor. One thing to highlight here is, in our conversations with the FCA, where we do meet them regularly in respect of safeguarding, the expectation is very much so that actually it's been 2 years since the guidance came out. Firms should really be in a position of having completed the first year and moving on to the subsequent audits. So for firms who are still considering and looking at the first year, we would really recommend having a really good rationale and a plan going forward should the FCA start asking for these audits. The other thing, when the FCA asked for these audits, just to clarify, the audit opinion is addressed to the firm and it is submitted to the firm. It's not submitted to the FCA, which is slightly different than the CAS regime. But that's the case at the moment. The FCA very much has the ability to request the firms for these audit opinions, but at the moment they're not being submitted to the FCA directly. So what are we seeing from the audits that we've done? Well, they have been clean opinions issued. That should perhaps not be a surprise given that this regime and this regulatory regime is still evolving and firms are getting more and more comfortable with complying with it, and in terms of guidance from the regulator as well. So clearly there are exceptions noted. You can call them exceptions. You can look at it as breaches of the rules with the safeguarding requirements. They have been noted on the reports, and as a result of it, we've not issued, and from my understanding, there haven't been many unmodified opinions issued in the market as well. Post the audit, or as the firms continue, going through these audits, there's a very clear focus on the articulation of business lines and activities and scope of safeguarding. Again, this is what I mentioned to earlier on. It's absolutely fundamental to understand and articulate what's in scope of safeguarding. And we've seen firms going back as a result of the first year audit and really tightening the footprint and the parameters of safeguarding. In some cases, seeking legal opinions as well, because unless you have absolute clarity on what are the business lines, what are the products which are not only in scope of safeguarding, but outside the scope as well, that's absolutely fundamental. And we've seen some communications between firms and FCA as well, where if they have deemed a certain business line to be out of scope, they have engaged with the regulator to clarify that as well. So that's an area we can see quite a lot of movement on post the audits as well. We've seen the consideration of period to the audit and the period end date. Over the last 2 years, some firms have gone for 6 months, some firms have gone for 12 months, but this is the time after having done and completed the first year audit. They're really looking at what is the right period for this audit. Do we need to align it with the financial year end, or are they disconnecting with the financial year end? You don't have to align it to the accounting and the financial year end. So again, it depends on the firm, but we've seen considerations around that as well. And another thing, and last point on this slide, but clearly very much important, is the controls framework and the organizational arrangements. So at what we have seen across the, based on our experience of these audits, some of the advisory work we've been doing as well, is it is a journey, and firms continue to tighten and document the documentation of the control framework for the safeguarding requirements. So those of you who may be familiar with the CAS regime, when the standard came out for that and formalized it, there was a lot of work that went into the whole documentation of controls mapping, the risk assessment. This is where we see the safeguarding regime and the safeguarding market to be at this point in time. It's all about really going back and say, what are the relevant controls to ensure compliance with the safeguarding requirements? Are they well documented? Can we map it back to the requirements? And really, can we demonstrate the organizational arrangements in a documented form, which have the right oversight and the right approval? So again, we are seeing a lot of work that has been done around that post the first year audits, or even where firms are looking at the first year audits as well. Again, a lot of work is going into that pre-audit work in respect of this. So that's some high-level sort of audit oversight in terms of what we are seeing across, based on our experience of the audits and based on some of the work and going on in the industry. Just to go a little bit more into detail in terms of what are the type of exceptions and what are the type of breaches, if you may call it, in respect of the safeguarding requirements that we are coming across, which are being then included into the audit opinions. As I mentioned, scoping and footprint, we've seen, we have noted exceptions in respect of this. And this is really when the firms are not very clear as to why one product or business line is in scope of the safeguarding audit as opposed to the other. It may be in terms of the flow of funds, it may be in terms of the timing of funds, but where the rationale isn't documented and is not in line with the relevant regulations, clearly that's an area of exception that's been raised. And inadequate documentation of flows, again, we are finding that there might be a very high level documentation of flows in respect of relevant funds and the controls, but they're not always very well articulated, specifically in terms of the timing of settlements and the timing of movements between the various parties in the chain, and when the funds arise and when they end up being safeguarding and segregated. So again, if that's not clear, it's very difficult to test the controls and documentation around that. Books and records, absolutely a fundamental underlying principle premise for these audits. You know, when you look at these, you can look at the safeguarding requirements pretty much around four, you know, four or five fundamental principles of identification of the funds, of segregating them in a proper manner, accuracy of books and records, as well as affording the right trust status to where the accounts are held. So again, you can see that the accurate books and records, again, we tend to see exceptions around that, especially because of the real-time processing of the flows in this sector, right? So things are always moving. It's not stopping. Sometimes there's multi-jurisdictions involved. Sometimes there's different payment channels of bags, JABs, other payments of PSPs involved. What are the timing the funds are actually hitting the account? What are the times they are being settled and segregated? So again, based on that, it's absolutely important in terms of understanding and being comfortable with the accuracy of books and records. And sometimes we've seen that there are challenges in, you know, updating the records on a daily basis. Well, then how can, you know, as a firm, you demonstrate that the books and records are accurate? Because ultimately you're looking at all of this with an insolvency mindset. So they have to be, the accuracy of books and records is absolutely fundamental. Moving on, reconciliations, that's another challenging, very topical area where we are finding that there seems to be a lack of there seems to be ambiguity or around the clarity between the difference between an internal reconciliation and an external reconciliation. So the calculations that the firms are doing in terms of safeguarding are not always looking at it with the lens of what's an internal reconciliation and what's an external reconciliation. The requirement is for both in the rules, and firms really need to be clear on this. So again, we are seeing you know, sort of challenges around that. One of the points that we are coming across is reconciliations are really sometimes being carried out and looked at and assessed on a transaction level, right? And that might well be because they're looking at it from the point of a settlement channel or from a merchant, you know, from a merchant channel. Again, reconciliation, all of these exceptions are being noted, similarly in terms of the policy as well as the discrepancies as well. So again, an area that really we are finding exceptions around. If we can move on then, some of the other common areas, commingling of relevant funds, again, a very common breach and exception. This is not only to do with the removal of fees and really understanding at what time is the fee being removed from the segregated account, but it will also in terms of when there is some sort of pre-funding and advance funding occurring because of the timing of the flow. Sometimes the firms are putting in the money to pre-fund or to support the settlement. And at what time are those corporate funds being mixed with the relevant funds and being removed? And this is again very closely linked to the concept of the estimation and collateralization that we are seeing across you know, quite a few firms in this sector. And whilst the rules do apply or do allow for estimates to be made in terms of relevant funds, so the FCA rule, FCA does acknowledge that if there is some sort of variability and ambiguity in terms of the amount of funds that need to be segregated, it's okay to use an estimate. And based on that, you know, firms can reasonably estimate, you know, what level of relevant funds need to be segregated. But for that, it needs to be backed by proper historical data, rationale, and reasoning. And again, we are seeing that there is some sort of over-collateralization and excess money is being left in the segregated accounts. So clearly, that's an area of exception that's being noted. Bank accounts, as I mentioned, absolutely fundamental. So really understanding of the firm, what's the difference between a segregated and a safeguarding account? Is there right titles to these accounts? And have they been afforded the right protection in terms of the acknowledgement letter? We're seeing challenges around the overseas banks. And again, what sort of acknowledgement letters are there in place if the template is not being used? In the revised approach document, there is a template that has been mandated or provided by the FCA. Again, how closely are firms really following that in terms of their safeguarding accounts? And the last point on there is really in terms of exceptions around organizational arrangements, because ultimately, the firms need to have adequate organizational arrangements in order to minimize the loss of, risk of loss or diminution to the funds that they are holding. Again, the exceptions that we come across or we have noted are around inadequate due diligence in credit institutions. How well has that been documented and considered? Inadequate safeguarding policies and procedures, as well as the oversight and use of agents. Again, I would really emphasize on the fact that this comes back to really understanding the business model and flows. We are, with these business model, we are seeing complexities around multiple PSPs involved around the chain at multiple points in payment channels. The relevant funds are arising and being settled. If you don't have oversight of the use of those agents and third parties, it's very difficult to then confirm that at what point the funds become relevant, what point the obligation starts and ends, and therefore, how can you demonstrate adequate organizational arrangements? So I hope that's given you a bit of feel. I think that those were the key points that I really wanted to cover in terms of the safeguarding audits framework itself and some of the insights that we've had from the latest audits. And I think with that, now I'm going to pass it over to Paul.
Thank you, Shameen. That's been really helpful. And Shameen, modest as she is, actually chairs the Institute's working group on CAS and safeguarding. So she's well positioned to give us those insights. But it won't surprise you that in addition to our audit work, we were also being active in terms of our advisory work, in particular, not only helping firms prepare for their safeguarding audits, but also deal with the corrective or remedial actions that have flowed from those audits. So we just thought we'd perhaps provide also a little bit of an advisory perspective here. And just building on what Shameen's already said, I think certainly from our perspective, we do believe that FCA has a perception here that firms have very much had plenty of time, ample time to meet the requirements and get their houses in order. That's not to say that there won't be ongoing improvements, but you'd hope that the fundamental gaps or deficiencies have been addressed by this point, given the fact that the FCA has been banging this drum since 2019 quite loudly. But the audit reports are really important, actually, because they're going to be an obvious supervisory tool for the FCA. Not to say that those reports are being shared with the FCA by default, but clearly the FCA has the discretion to request those reports, and it will use the information and the commentary within them to inform their assessment of firms, how compliant or otherwise that they are. So it's a really rich, it should be a rich point of intelligence for the FCA to scrutinize firms on a risk basis. Obviously, just like organizations, the FCA is limited in terms of its resources, so we can expect a risk-based approach in terms of further follow-ups. But here we've also perhaps listed some questions fundamental questions that the FCA would be interested in reading these audit reports. And I think it's fair to say that we certainly will expect to see a flow of Section 166 activity, unfortunately, off the back of poor audit reports, or where indeed the FCA has reviewed firms and has some fundamental concerns in terms of their compliance. I hope that's helpful. But let's move on from safeguarding and bring up our next poll. And our question here is about the wind down plans. And the question we'd like to ask you is, when did you last review your wind down plan? Perhaps it's currently under review. In terms of refinements, perhaps it's been looked at in the last year or so, perhaps more than a year ago, or perhaps you're still kind of in the process of drafting it, of pulling it together, and it's perhaps not ready for the review by the FCA or a third party yet. Just while those results are coming in, I mean, it's important to emphasise here that there's the expectation very much that the wind down plan is a living, breathing document that's reflective of your business and the practical implications of a severe but realistic and plausible wind down scenario. And hopefully those results are just coming in now. There we go, just like magic. So actually more than half of you have looked at your wind down plan in the previous 12 months, which I think is great, you know. And perhaps it's a question as what is the mechanism through which you are continually updating that and revisiting it with the necessary involvement of senior management? A number of you saying that it's currently under review, so perhaps explains why a number of you have joined us today. Only 5% saying that it's under development or we don't have one yet. So that's a really good juncture for us to bring in Will Staggs, a director in our insolvency and restructuring practice. Thanks, Will.
Thank you, Paul and Shameen, and good morning, everyone. As Paul said, I'm Will Stagg, a director in our financial services restructuring and insolvency team, and I'm also a licensed insolvency practitioner. So I typically work with businesses in distressed situations, but we've also done a lot of work in supporting firms all throughout their life cycle, in particular in putting together their wind down plans. So today, what I wanted to do is give a brief update on wind down plans, particularly from a practical perspective, and some of the learnings that we've seen on live jobs from the FCA's feedback, but also in terms of developments in insolvency law that are specific to payment and e-money firms. Of course, I hope you won't have to engage with that insolvency law, but I think it is an important regulatory area to be aware of, as it supports the foundation of a strong regulatory environment and landscape for payment and e-money firms, and it does ensure the best outcomes for customers, even in a time of distress. In terms of the poll results, very much echo Paul's comments. Actually, I was expecting a slightly broader spread when we ran a similar poll perhaps 18 months ago in terms of where people thought their wind down plan was at from a kind of completion perspective. There was a much heavier weighting towards the bottom end of the spectrum and it not being complete. So it's positive to see that they now appear to be slightly more living, breathing documents, as Paul mentioned. So, you know, taking a step back, we're all acutely aware of the economic pressures facing our economy at this point in time, both for attendees on this call, but also for the customers that we all work with. You know, we've got high inflation and rising interest rates, a challenge that, you know, that will be borne both by consumers, but also by businesses, and there is already and there's likely to continue to be reducing consumer spend, increasing debt levels, and increasing vulnerability coming off the back of already an increase in vulnerability during as a result of COVID. So, you know, all of this, the indicators are suggesting could lead to depressed transaction volume and value, and rising delinquencies in books. And in terms of corporates and firms out there, you know, there's challenges as Shameen and Paul have touched on in terms of increased regulatory oversight. We're seeing rising debt levels, but that tends to be funding survival rather than growth at the moment. Ongoing working capital challenges, again driven by that delinquency point in part. And, you know, real stresses and challenges to a firm's financial and operational resilience. And you know, we've seen this kind of publicly, and again, looking at the FT, at some of the larger names, you know, you pick up just on Klarna and Revolut and their recent announcements around cost-cutting measures and significant scale-backs they're having to put in terms of staffing in response to delinquencies and pressures on margins. So it's a really challenging market for firms, no matter what subsector you're targeting or exposed to. And just as a recent piece of research, albeit this is with a specific consumer hat on, we Grant Thornton and Retail Economics did some research a few months ago, shown in the graph on this page, looking at what the estimated cutback in spending might be. And as you can see, there is assumed cutbacks across all income levels, right from the least affluent to the most affluent. And you know, that was before that research was done, before the mini budget came in, and we've had further market turmoil. So it won't be a surprise to anyone in this call that wind down plans will remain a key regulatory requirement and a focus of the FCA as a tool to prepare firms for the challenges ahead. And it was in some FCA research in 2021 that they specifically called out concerns around low levels of financial resilience in payments and e-money. So if we could just move on to the next slide, please. So, you know, as I said, the FCA is increasingly proactive in challenging wind down plans, and they've given some kind of public feedback to the industry in terms of some of the review work they've done and some of the findings that they've made. So in 2021, they released some guidance off the back of 14 wind down plans that they had reviewed, and their overarching comment was not one of those plans had met their expectations. And so some of the common omissions that were raised by the FCA in that report, and which we've also seen in practice in live situations, I'll just go through some of those on that list now. So in terms of the repatriation of customer funds, again, it's in the detail here. Wind down plan needs a really detailed explanation of how that repatriation would be carried out, how it would be funded, and in particular the timeline for that process, all the employees, suppliers, systems, etc., that would need to be operational and working to facilitate that repatriation. So a real granular understanding of how that process would work. In terms of consideration of necessary funding, again, it's the breadth of that consideration. So it has to include all of those costs that you might not see in a BAU scenario, but you would see in a wind down. So redundancy payments, IT maintenance costs of an actual external advisor, involving specialist consultants, or perhaps retention payments, because you'd inevitably lose people when you transition towards a wind down. So the level of detail on that side is regularly challenged, and you need to demonstrate that proper interrogation has gone into that mapping of the funding requirement, both in a solvent wind down and in an insolvent wind down if you were to pivot to that scenario. IT and cyber controls was another one that was raised. There's obviously so much technical development in this area and change, and so much rapid change that, you know, quickly a wind down plan can come out of date in that regard. And so it's really positive to see in those survey results that plans have either been revisited in the last 12 months or are currently live in the review process at this point in time. Consideration of a wind down of a product or a subsidiary. Often there's a lack of thought from firms into how an individual product wind down or a subsidiary wind down might affect a group and might affect the wider wind down approach. More often than not, there will be knock-on impacts on one to the other. An announcement around one product will impact another, and the same with a subsidiary. And more often than not, there's cross dependencies within a firm. There might be servicing arrangements between subsidiaries within it or across product lines. And so all of that kind of cross dependency needs to be considered and mapped out. In terms of triggers, and this is a really big one for the FCA, the challenge here is that it's easy to write down a list of kind of generic triggers that identify general distress in the firm or the market. But the FCA pushes firms to make those as specific and measurable as possible. They really can't be kind of general concepts. And what the FCA is looking for there is looking for triggers that a board can regularly review and update performance against and measure itself against. And so they really need to be specific to the individual firm, as well as, of course, having that kind of industry sector focus. The other point on triggers is firms often forget there's typically two sets of triggers. So there are the triggers for a solvent wind down. And then once in that solvent wind down, there are triggers that would push the firm into an insolvent wind down and therefore a different direction. So there is that two layers to that triggering process that it's often missed out in wind down plans. Next one is directors not reviewing right information to allow them to make decisions to wind down before insolvency is inevitable. Again, the issue is timing. Timing is key. The directors of a firm need to understand that pivot between solvent and insolvent. And so it's further support around the importance of those triggers and their ability for them to be measured. And the last one from the 2021 review that I'm pulling out for today is just the non-identification of necessary third-party providers. A lot of the time we see wind-down plans that just fundamentally assume that all suppliers will continue servicing in a wind-down. And there hasn't been any challenge on kind of key suppliers as to the fragilities in that relationship, any kind of contractual abilities those suppliers might have to, you know, charge kind of ransom charges or renegotiate the contract in a wind down situation, or even walk away from that. So, you know, the expectation from the FCA is that those key suppliers are named, identified, and specifically interrogated in terms of their importance to that wind down plan. What we then saw very recently from the FCA just a couple of months ago was a paper in terms of assessing liquidity for orderly wind down, good and poor practices for general insurance brokers. I'm not talking to an insurance audience at the moment, but again, you know, the commentary that came out of there and the good practices that they've identified are just as relevant for payments and e-money firms. So I thought I'd just mention a few of those here. First of all, it's the clear identification and regular review of the risks inherent in your business model and mitigating steps to reduce related harms. So, you know, any wind down plan I see, the governance section and the risk section are real significant parts of that wind down plan. Detailed and well thought out cash flow projections and assumptions, which help with operational and credible planning. Very similar to the kind of cost outline I've mentioned from the 2021 review. The FCA, they're really looking for granular cash flow forecasts to show, you know, weekly, monthly cash forecast payments, including those payments that you'd only get in a wind down around retention payments, around supplier ransom payments, renegotiation of contracts, etc. So they really want to see that the firm has put significant effort into mapping that cash flow forecast and understanding the actual cost of a solvent wind down, and again, in terms of how that might change into an insolvent wind down. On those cash flows projections and modeling, stress testing and reverse stress testing, again, the expectation is that that kind of work is, that sensitivity analysis is done and stress testing is done to improve the modelling and wind down planning, and really to help the firm identify the risk ratio of this and the possible upsides and downsides in a wind down scenario. A strong risk management framework, including risk metrics and forward looking management information. Obviously, a repeat, as we always see, and I can only emphasize again, is to regularly review those wind down plans. You know, both Paul and Shameen have touched on the rate of change in the industry, and so the importance of regularly reviewing that and updating that. And finally, the modelling of the minimum liquidity required to ensure an orderly wind down. Again, there is a suggestion that this should be revisited at least annually, or in response to a major change to the business model or risk profile. So hopefully that provides a few examples of areas where when you read your next wind down plan, you can consider further challenge and development of its content. Just moving on to the next slide in terms of benefits of wind down planning. So as I said, you know, it's a really challenging and changing economic environment. We've got continued focus from the regulator on wind down plans. It'd be great to change the mindset on wind down plans to, rather than being a requirement from a regulatory tick box, to really move it to understand the benefits of a well-considered wind down plan. In my view, if done properly, so with the appropriate time, investment of time and expertise across the firm, it can provide really helpful insight into strengths and weaknesses of the business, the level of operational and financial resilience, and importantly, some of those key measurable and identifiable triggers that may support your business in quickly identifying incoming distress and responding to that. So really, it can be a driver for change, and it can help identify where a new approach could actually improve your resilience. And in a worst case outcome, which I hope no one here in this call gets into, but in a worst case outcome, it will fundamentally improve the recovery options and the customer outcomes in that circumstance. If I could move on to the next slide. So I just, conscious of time, I'll just move on to the new insolvency regime for the sector. So if we just go back to 2008, quickly in the global financial crisis, the objectives in an administration were to rescue a company as a going concern or maximise recoveries for creditors. The financial crisis really exposed the challenges of the system for consumers, and so the Banking Act introduced a special insolvency regime for financial institutions, and that refocused that objective in terms of protecting customer funds held by institutions. Since then, obviously, we've had the rapid expansion of the payments and e-money sector, and that has revealed that insolvency processes for this sector are still suboptimal. You know, there is a large number of creditors in these cases of customers that typically administrators have great difficulties in winding down firms efficiently and returning money to customers and other creditors. And in many cases, it can take years to resolve in the payments and e-money space. So there was a consultation paper in December 2020 where the FCA highlighted this point. I think Paul mentioned it, where six of the recent cases of a payment e-money failure, only one of them had actually resulted in returns to customers. So in kind of positive news on that basis, in November 2021, the payment and electronic money insolvency rules came into effect, and there was a new procedure, a special administration regime called a PSAR for short, that now applies to payment and e-money firms. Typically administrations weren't designed for fintechs, e-money banks, and the concept of customer funds is a challenging concept for the previous legislation. You know, if we look at a couple of the insolvencies again that I think Paul mentioned around Premier FX and Igapu, the the delays to the customer recoveries have been significant, have been multi-year. So the overarching aim really is to enable a speedier and more efficient return of customer monies in that event. If we could just go on to the next slide, please. So what the new legislation has achieved is, as an administrator, we've now got an expanded toolkit of powers, both to keep an insolvent institution operational, but also to prioritise the return of customer funds. So as I said, in a standard administration, you've got to complete one of three duties. You either rescue the company as a going concern, you achieve a better result for your company's creditors as opposed to a liquidation process, or you realise property to make a distribution to secured or preferential creditors. There are different objectives under the PSAR regime. So firstly, it's to ensure the return of relevant funds as soon as is reasonably practical. It's to ensure timely engagement with the payment system operators, and it's to either rescue the institution as a going concern or to wind it up in the best interests of creditors. And as an insolvency practitioner, we need to specify which one of those we're giving priority to. And the FCA also has the power to direct us to a particular objective if they think that is deemed appropriate to protect the stability of the financial sector. Just go on to the next slide, please. So given those objectives, what are the key features designed to help an administrator achieve those objectives? Well, the objective itself, to return customer funds as soon as reasonably practical, that empowers an administrator to focus our strategy in that way. So that objective in itself is helpful. It strengthens our powers to create a bar date for customers to put claims in, to really speed up the distribution process. Typically, bar dates are a bit more challenging around UK legislation. You'll get creditor claims trickle in over time and you have to continue to adapt to deal with those. There's a mechanism to facilitate the transfer of customer funds to a solvent institution, so a lift and shift of the book. There's the post-administration reconciliation to establish back to the safeguarded accounts that Shameen mentioned earlier, whether there's top-ups or drawdowns required from those accounts. Previously, administrators under a normal administration have had lengthy legal disputes as to ownership of funds and where there's shortfalls, how that shortfall is funded, and the blurring of lines between company money and customer money. Provisions for continuity of supply. So again, that's empowering administrators to deal with suppliers, particularly in such a technical space, that we ensure that we have that continued supply in an administration. Rules for treatment of shortfall and rules for allocation of costs. Again, a really challenging issue that a lot of insolvency practitioners have had to take to court to establish ownership and right to funds and how we deal with shortfalls. So generally a set of features that really support an IP insolvency practitioner carry out that duty to return funds as quickly as possible. So just very briefly to finish off from my side, why is this relevant for this audience? I've just mentioned a few points on that. Firstly, a market needs an effective and efficient failure mechanism or a restructuring option to allow for its proper functioning. So this has got added benefits, you know, increases the level of trust in investors can place in that market and the way they can recover from that market in a circumstance of failure. It also emphasises some of the points that Shameen has covered off earlier. It interacts with the wider regulatory approach to payment e-money and safeguarding of funds. And so the whole regulatory landscape is coming together at the same time. And most importantly, from the FCA's perspective, it will create the best outcome for customers. And so again, it will improve the perception of the market and the operation of that market. So I think I'll hand back to Paul there. Apologies, I'm slightly overrun on my slot.
always the case, Will. It's always the case. And hopefully what we've been able to demonstrate there is how good practice around your safeguarding arrangements, for example, around accurate records, effective reconciliations, that will ultimately make the insolvency practitioner's job on that event a lot easier. I think we're inevitably running out of time. What I'm going to propose to do is, rather than keep people longer than they planned, we've received three or five questions, and I'm going to propose that we respond to people individually in respect of those questions that have been raised. But look, thank you everyone for joining us this morning. I hope you found it a really helpful session, and do get in touch with us if we can help. And here at Grant Thornton, we do run an ongoing program of financial services webinars. So visit our website, sign up for the events that are run on an ongoing basis. And we thank you again for joining us, and hope to see you again next time.